Only 11 seconds of one logo? This movie's from 1974, people. Where did we go wrong? Just because I'm pissed off now, I'm gonna give an undeserved sin to this movie.
One more!
It looks like Paul ascribes to the take a picture, it'll last longer philosophy with his wife.
You're not gonna show those to anyone, are you?
Sure, why not?
Revenge porn. Hawaii! Airports! Death wish! Holy shit, this music's disorienting. I know the movie takes a dark turn shortly, but this shit is like horror movie fanfare. Who the hell did this score? Fucking Herbie Hancock! The guy from Valerian and the City of a Thousand Planets? The Seven Train. And Hope Lang! She dies soon. Goddamn, this movie's only been going on for 3 minutes, but they make the trip from Hawaii to New York seem as long as it actually is in real life. Man, I sure am glad we've got the time to see all the mundane shit that the Kerseys do upon arriving at home. Like checking the fucking mail. Otherwise, how would we know who the head grip is for this movie? They travel together, they eat together, and they sleep together. Yep, they're definitely a married couple. I'm glad the opening credits could hammer that home for us. What the hell is this future tech, where you can turn off both bed lamps at the same time? Does Paul have an Amazon Echo? A Google Home? A clapless clapper?
You want to know what was happening while you and Joanna were living it up in Maui or Cowie or Yowie, whatever it is?
Apparently in the 70s, Maui was still so exotic that it sounded like it came from Lord of the Rings. And to simply call it by name was something that nerds did.
You are such a bleeding heart liberal, Paul.
Stick 'em in concentration camps, that's what I say.
Movie predicts roughly 86% of Twitter content.
But what this city needs is more cops than people.
No one could pay the taxes.
Now here's a cash register to drive home the point about taxes. Wow, these assholes need to get on the same mayhem page, considering this thug puts the ham back before continuing the store shenanigans. Discount Jeff Goldblum.
Dad, we got trouble.
Trouble, you and Cal. Don't tell me about it.
Person interrupts someone before they get the chance to tell them what's really going on, cliche. Also, why is his son-in-law calling him? Wouldn't the cops or the hospital already have called Paul?
Were they cut, stabbed, what?
No, sir. Just beat up.
Officer Exposition is extremely nonchalant about delivering this convenient information, even bemused.
What'd they tell you?
Not much.
The last 2 minutes of this movie have been Paul asking Jack, what happened? And Jack saying, I don't know. Now apparently he knows at least not much. I mean, Jesus, get on with it.
They beat them both up.
First, he has no information. Then he plays the pronoun game with what he does know.
The officer said that Kara wasn't making much sense. Two, maybe three men, she opened the door to let them in because she thought it was the delivery boy from the supermarket.
Yeah, Carol must have been in a total daze to tell that cop that cockamamie story.
Your wife is all right.
You probably don't give a shit about your mother-in-law, though, so that's 100% good news. Luckily, everyone remembered to bring their black funeral umbrellas today instead of their Debbie Reynolds singing in the rain ones.
It's time I went to my own. I have to sometime.
I mean, it's been two whole days. You gotta move on. I might even start dating again. Dude, I know New Yorkers honk a lot, but at a fucking funeral?
This is Mr. Paul Kiersey, case number 884. His wife and daughter were assaulted.
So why does Joe continue to look so goddamn happy about it?
I'd know you, Mr. Kiersey.
Right
this
way,
Mr. Kiersey. You have a seat, Mr. Kiersey?
One thing I like to do when I'm on a case is call someone by name 3 times within 5 seconds. It's a fun thing I do. Just ignore me.
But I haven't been able to pick the faces out of the mug book.
The 3 guys who assaulted Joanna and Carol definitely have criminal records, and one of them is Jeff Goldblum. Don't tell me they couldn't pick that dude out of a mug book.
Are you getting the most out of life?
Advert irony. It's in times like these one has to buckle down and drink a glass full of grief milk. Wow, what a massive coincidence that this loud theft happens just when Paul was looking out the window during his nightly milk chug. Also, how the shit did this dude get such great parking in the city? I mean, look at the size of that space. This spot is so good, the car owner probably deserved a break-in. Back in the 70s, New York had a if-you-see-something-close-the-blinds policy.
$20 in quarters, please.
Paul just read the vigilante handbook, which states that when you start vigilanteing, start with the sock full of quarters. You want to wail on shoplifters first, then work your way up to pickpockets.
But can I give you an answer in about a week? I don't want to leave New York just now because of Carol.
And besides, New York is a cesspool of crime and nobody cares, and I've got a lot of ass to kill.
How the hell do I remind her of that day?
Look, I know Charles Bronson was a badass and was in some classic movies, but all I'm saying is there's a reason he never starred in a Shakespearean production.
Dad, don't make it tough for me.
This son-in-law character calls Paul Dad so much, it's a wonder that Paul didn't start his murderous spree several years ago. Charles Bronson in The Taking of the M16 10th Avenue Bus. Jesus. Paul's looking for any reason to use that sock full of quarters, isn't he?
Son of a bitch. Turn around, son of a bitch.
Paul stumbles into 1974 New York and gets accosted by a mugger. I mean, come on, guys. New York is not like this anymore. Rudy Giuliani and Travis Bickle cleaned up the city. I mean, oh, is this really 1974? But I saw a record player in Jack's apartment. Didn't those just come out last year? Yeah, that's a $20 bitch slap right there. Quarters, bitch. Holy shit. Just imagine what $40 worth of quarters would do. Death Wish tutorial mode.
You know who I was?
You look like in New York?
That's racist. Looks like the director and the sound effects supervisor had a conflict about the appropriate amount of mooing.
I got funny ideas about building things.
Yep, this revenge story definitely has time to delve into Paul's architectural relationship with this cowboy developer.
That's what I whistle for. I trot you back to the motel.
I have no doubt this guy is an important person in Tucson, but they just let him drive his car into the studio a lot like this? Tell you what, you try driving your car inside Disneyland and tell me what they say, because I have charges pending and I want to trip them up in court.
Marshall! Hey, Marshall!
Man, Westworld really got shitty after Yul Brynner got through with it. Jeez, if they get any tighter on Paul's face, we'll be able to see his cellular structure. You know, this scene ain't half bad. The people watching this don't feel the need to do anything because they're simply watching a show. But Paul sees that in everyday life, people let real violence go on all the time and feel powerless to stop it. So it makes sense this triggers something in Paul, and hell, I'll remove a sin for it.
It's a goddamn much hoopla from the gun control people. Half the nation's scared to even hold a gun.
Wow. It's amazing how dated this film is. Sensible gun control has been a part of the American fabric for so long, it's hard to believe there was a time people had to fight for better laws. Didn't Ames say he was going up to the club for dinner tonight? Isn't this the club? But where the hell are the other members? And is the food served at the range? Do they have to kill their own dinners? Damn it, I have so many questions about this gun club.
I was a CO in a medical unit.
Commanding officer, huh?
Conscientious objector.
Oh, is that what the CO stands for in the military? Because someone might think that term is a bit misleading. Fucking 70s movies, man. What the fuck was that cutaway? It lasted less than a second, and it was weird. It's all right, sweetheart. I'll go murder some fools, and that'll get you back on your feet. Movie once again treats us to some hot returning from a trip mail action. Jesus, how does such a short movie feel so goddamn long?
What a bummer, man. That was the worst fucking movie I've ever seen.
Random goofballs were somehow already able to see the 2018 Death Wish remake. Look, I know it's dangerous in the city and all, but it only takes a few minutes for Paul to find someone with a raging crime boner. Also, it's amazing that in 1974, along with The Conversation, there were two movies where someone on top of a hill followed another person at the bottom of a hill. One was a fantasy sequence, sure, but what the fuck was with the hill following back in 1974? Also, why would this thug be targeting a dude that's in relatively good shape and is looking right at it? Isn't the element of surprise important, as is picking an easy mark? This dude is criminaling all wrong. Ebola. Wait, there are a million crimes happening in the city every day, right? So why would this one killing of a societal miscreant take up the entirety of the front page? Ah, the blood effects of the 1970s. They were the digitally removed mustache in Justice League of the day. Are these the same nuns from earlier? Are the nuns like the oranges in The Godfather, where they foreshadow bad events? Or did they walk all the way from Manhattan to Long Island over the past few days? Okay, the killings are important, but this looks like everyone in the precinct gathered for this speech. Surely the secretaries or the auxiliary staff have other things to do, right? It's as if trouble is attracted to Paul right now. If trouble and Paul were in a love story, we'd call it serendipity. Apparently these thugs like to warm up with several seconds of good old staring. Dude, you can walk between cars for a reason. One is if you kill two people and want to get away with it, you can walk off one of the cars that don't have dead people in it.
Which appears to be the work of the person New York news media have dubbed the vigilante.
A term so vague that you might not even call it a name at all. It's like calling a robber the robber, or calling a band led by Lee Von Helm the band.
Now it has been confirmed that the same gun, a .32 pistol, which was used in the previous three homicides, was used last night.
Hang on, Paul previously killed four people in two other incidents. So either way, the chief is looking at this wrong. Back in 1974, people watched TV with a strangely projected image directly on the TV, rather than the image actually coming from the TV.
We couldn't get any prints off the vigilante's grocers.
Really? Paul wasn't wearing gloves when he shot the subway muggers. And that's f***ing cellophane right there, so why the f*** are there no prints on it?
There goes the pussy posse.
When this movie came out in July of 1974, Leonardo DiCaprio and Tobey Maguire did not exist. David Blaine did, though. Coincidence? Hooker booger. Did Paul stake this place out before going in? Did he know that this diner was a hotbed of criminal activity and potential muggers? I mean, judging from this movie, New York was made up of 56% muggers back in the day. Paul passes three people in this subway stop, and that is all the people in New York in this subway station in a well-trafficked area. Paul not only finds muggers to kill, but also finds the pockets of New York with no witnesses.
What else you got? I see the money, man.
Damn, I think the main reason guns are outlawed in New York City is the booming switchblade lobbies keeping them out.
Went that way.
Cop does nothing to detain this random dude that's standing right next to the dead body. Ah, well, I guess he definitely didn't get on this train that just closed its doors. Gotta get back to my routine of horrible copping.
Exact words. I cut that motherfucker. I hit him.
I don't know if I should remove a sin for that line or add one. I guess I'll go to the default.
The two men have been identified. Both had long criminal records.
Man, it sure is good for Paul that all the assholes he's killed so far have been assholes, and not just desperate, hungry poor people.
Who today successfully defended herself against two muggers with an unusual weapon.
With a hatpin!
Oh yeah, these people who have been inspired by Paul are definitely not going to get murdered using those types of weapons. The fuck is wrong with these folks? who gathers to talk in a stairwell at a cocktail party.
You notice he kills more blacks than whites.
Oh, for Pete's sake, Harry, more blacks are muggers than whites.
And from this cocktail party, Fox News was born.
Conscientious objectors are unlikely vigilantes. We got a finger?
Yeah, over there. Patrolman Joe Charles.
What the f*** is that about? Is Joe a bad cop? Does this detective hate black people? Why did he say that guy's name like that? Bloody paper towel sniffing.
You're being watched.
Dial tone after the other person has hung up cliche. Paul is contemplating quitting his life as a vigilante, so why is porn music playing? It's been at least a few weeks since the break-in, and this is supposedly a nice building, but they haven't at least washed the f***ing spray paint off the walls. But it was only three rings. What if he'd been in the shitter? Where does Paul keep all his bullets? They didn't find any at his apartment, and we never see him reloading the gun. But he's fired at least 13 shots during his rampage, and the revolver can only house 6 shells. It's weird, the last 20 minutes of this movie are the detective chasing after Paul. But the powers that be don't want to arrest him. They just want to scare him out of being a vigilante. I mean, is the detective's main purpose here to catch Paul in the act, where he'll be forced to arrest him? I'm not sure what's at stake here. For the third time today, Paul walks past a billboard advertising a magazine that directly relates to this story. I think this movie was once called Three Billboards Reminding the Audience What This Movie Is About Over New York, New York.
Weird.
Character description written in the margins of this screenplay is accidentally said out loud as dialogue. I thought muggings were down by like 50%. And if that's the case, shouldn't it be way down in this neighborhood, where most of the vigilante attacks have been happening? Don't the muggers in the city spread the word at their weekly meetings? Paul shoots at the guy with the knife first, even though the dude at the top of the stairs had a fucking gun trained on him. Does he have a major issue with afros or something? Even though he's been a crack shot this whole time, Paul whips out his finest stormtrooper aim to set up the final act of the movie. Seriously, blood effects in the 70s were so bad I genuinely thought this was paint. Not just in real life, but in the movie too. Paul Kersey briefly morphs into Anton Chigurh in this scene. I mean, seriously, he simply will not stop until he's murdered this dude that he's never met before tonight.
Hey, fill your hand.
Paul, who's never given any of these criminals any chance to survive, decides to turn this last killing into a f***ing old-timey western duel. Also, get your rooster cogburn out of my death wish, dammit.
They told me on the radio you had to see me.
Paul Kersey.
God damn it, dude. You have something to say, so say it.
What did you get?
His address, sir.
This motherfucker buries the lead and tells the detective he got Paul's address, when in fact he found Paul's gun. There's no reason to be this way, other than extending the movie's runtime and perhaps speculating that this actor will one day star in This Is Spinal Tap.
Get a transfer to another city, and I'll drop this gun in the river.
Boy, sure is nice that we wrapped that whole Carol's in a Catatonic State storyline up, eh?
We want you to get out of New York permanently.
And make 4 more sequels to this f***ing movie.
How do you explain the first reports we had that he is the vigilante?
False reports, it happens all the time.
Gaslighting. I've murdered a lot of people in the last few weeks for minor offenses without any information about their background or remorse for my actions.
Weird.
All we are is dust in the wind.
Paul, I'm going to give you a vacation.
A vacation from my problems!
When I was 5, my father introduced me to a friend of his, and for no reason at all, I hit him right in the stomach with all my strength. He died a year later.
Hey, mister. Got a match?
Yeah. My butt and your, butt.
The numbers all go to 11.
Does that mean it's louder? Is it any louder?
Well, it's one louder, isn't it?
Don't mess with the bull, young man. You'll get the horns.
Fill your hand.
Huh?
Grilled cheese.
What?
Grill me a cheese.